In some chemistry problems, you will need to be able to write algebraic equations, where each variable represents a value you're trying to find. Some of these questions will be word problems, while others will help you avoid having to do mental math. Two main chemistry topics that require you to know how to write algebraic equations are redox reactions and isotopes. For redox reactions, you will need to know how to find the oxidation numbers of each element. Recall that we use oxidation numbers or oxidation states to help us determine if electrons are being lost or gained and which reactant undergoes oxidation or reduction. There are specific oxidation number rules that you are required to memorize. These oxidation number rules are to be used in this specific order. Notice that these rules do not apply to each element on the periodic table. There are some that we will need to figure out by writing algebraic equations. Rule 1 is whenever one element is in its solid state, the oxidation number is 0. Rule 2 is whenever there are diatomic molecules, the oxidation number is 0. Note that these are not examples of diatomic molecules. We would use Rule 7 for the oxygens here. When O2 is on its own, then it is a diatomic molecule. Rule 3 is whenever an element is on its own and has a charge, the oxidation number is the charge. Rule 4 is whenever hydrogen is within a compound, the oxidation number of hydrogen is positive 1. Rule 5 is whenever elements in group 1 of the periodic table are within a compound, the oxidation number is positive 1. Rule 6 is whenever elements in group 2 of the periodic table are within a compound, the oxidation number is positive 2. Rule 7 is whenever oxygen is within a compound, the oxidation number of oxygen is negative 2. Rule 8 is whenever a halogen is within a compound, the oxidation number of the halogen is negative 1. Besides these rules, there is one more major thing to know. The sum of all oxidation numbers for all elements must add up to the total charge of the given compound, molecule, or ion. If they do not add up to the charge, then the oxidation numbers are wrong. This is a great way to check if you did this correctly. We'll apply these rules for the next examples. We will find the oxidation numbers for each element. Let's use our oxidation number rules in this order. The first rule that applies to this example in this order is Rule 4. We have a hydrogen within a compound, so the oxidation number of hydrogen is positive 1. Next, continuing down the list of rules, Rule 7 applies. So oxygen has an oxidation number of negative 2. And if we continue to Rule 8, it states that a halogen within a compound has an oxidation number of negative 1. But there is a problem here. If we added all of these oxidation numbers together, and note, since there are 3 oxygens, we would multiply 3 times negative 2 to get negative 6, so this is really what we would add together, we would see that this is not the overall charge of the compound, which is 0, since there is no charge shown. We instead get a negative 6 as our charge. This means one of our oxidation numbers is wrong. The last oxidation number was wrong since the other two were higher up on this list, and we know that the order matters. We need to write an algebraic equation. Start with bringing down the known oxidation numbers we previously found. So I'll bring down a positive 1, and for oxygen, we need to account for the 3 oxygens since there is a 3 subscript. So multiply the 3 subscript by our oxidation number of negative 2 to get negative 6 and bring that number down. Please note that this negative 6 is not the oxidation number. Its only purpose is to help find the missing oxidation number for chlorine. Place an X for chlorine since we don't know this value yet. And remember, we always have to add up all the oxidation numbers and set this equal to the total charge of the compound. So place a plus sign between each number and variable. Then set this equal to the charge of the compound, which is 0. Solve for X, combining like terms. 1 plus negative 6 is negative 5. Add the 5 to both sides. X is equal to 5, which means the oxidation number for chlorine is positive 5. Our oxidation numbers are these for each element. Here's another example. Again, we will start with finding the oxidation numbers we know using our oxidation number rules in this order. The only rule that applies is rule 7. Oxygen's oxidation number is negative 2. We need to write an algebraic equation. Start with the values you know, so we need to account for all 7 oxygens by multiplying the 7 times oxygen's oxidation number of negative 2. This gives us negative 14. Again, this negative 14 is not the oxidation number of oxygen. Its only purpose is to help write an algebraic equation and solve for the missing oxidation number. Since we don't know the oxidation number for chromium, we will place an X here. But there are 2 chromiums, so we need to multiply 2 times X to get 2X. Next, set this equal to the overall charge of the compound, which is negative 2. Note, we could have written the left side like this, where all oxidation numbers are being added together. But this wasn't necessary since these two mean the same thing. Now we can solve for X by adding the 14 to both sides. The 14s cancel and negative 2 plus 14 is 12. Divide both sides by 2. X is equal to 6. These are oxidation numbers. Our second chemistry topic where you need to know how to write algebraic equations is when you are asked to find the percent abundance of an isotope. This is our formula for percent abundance, where the average atomic mass or weight of all of the isotopes of that element is set equal to the sum of each individual isotope, where each isotope will have mass and percent abundance multiplied together in parentheses. For this question, we are given the masses of the 2 isotopes of copper and the overall average atomic weight of copper. We are asked to find the percent abundance of each isotope. So we have 2 unknown values that are different from each other. Since these isotopes must have different percent abundances, we can label this first isotope's percent abundance as X and the second isotope's percent abundance as Y. But we wouldn't be able to solve for this since there are 2 unknown variables. Instead, we want to make Y into an algebraic equation that is in terms of X. Remember, we are dealing with percentages, and we know that percentages are out of 100%. So we would essentially subtract 100% by X because whatever percent abundance we get from this first isotope must be subtracted by 100% to get our remaining percent abundance for the second isotope. We can represent this 100% as just a number 1. Remember, if we wanted to change 100% from a percentage into a decimal, or in this case, a whole number, we would simply divide by 100. So that's where the 1 comes from. Replace the y with 1 minus x, and this is the algebraic equation you would use to solve for this question. We could also rewrite this so that the numbers are in front, and so we remember to distribute here later. Multiplying this number and x, we get this. Next, distribute this value to both the 1 and the x to get this. We can continue combining like terms, so combine the x's together and bring down the rest of the problem. We can continue combining like terms by subtracting this value over. Finally, to get x by itself, we need to divide both sides by this negative value. Now that we found x, let's go back to what this question was asking for. We want to find the percent abundances of each isotope. We originally said that X represents this first isotope and 1 minus X represents the second isotope. We will plug in X here and subtract 1 minus our X value. Since these are percentages, we need to multiply both decimals by 100 to get the percent abundances of each isotope. We could have done this last step differently and found the first percentage, then subtracted this value from 100% to get our second percentage. Whichever way you prefer works. There are several variations of these types of questions, and to make sure you don't miss anything on your exam, I created a variety of practice problems for you to try on my website, melissa.help/practice. So click the link in the description, try those problems out, then come back for the next video.